In thermodynamics, a closed system is one where no mass exchange occurs, while an energy exchange does occur. We can add or remove energy, for example in the form of heat, electricity, or mechanical work. The simplest example for these systems is a closed piston cylinder, which we used in a previous example, link below, where whatever substance we have inside the system is not leaving the system, even though we can supply or obtain energy from the system. A special case of a closed system is what we call an isolated system, where neither mass nor energy is being exchanged. We'll run into some of those in some special examples, but that's all you need to know about them for now. Open systems are, on the other hand, systems where both matter and energy flow to and or from the system. An example of this can still be a piston, but in this case with an inlet where mass can flow into it. A turbine is another good example of open systems. There is a mass coming in, a mass coming out, and there will be energy leaving the system in the form of work. For all of these examples, the boundary that we set around them, or for a fraction of them, or for several of them connected to each other, whatever we set as a volume in space that is of interest to us, bounded by well-defined limits, is what we call a control volume. This is true even if the volume itself is changing, becoming larger or smaller as components move. So, for instance, in the piston cylinder example, even though the volume might be becoming smaller as the piston is pushed down, since the piston's head is what we can use as a boundary of our control volume, it would still be called a control volume. We often talk about systems, but for most of what we state for a system is also true for the control volume we select of a larger system. In general, a system is characterized by its properties. If the properties change, we'd say that its state changed. We'd say that the system has undergone a process. On a 2D plot, where we show a system's properties, we can show the state of a system as a dot. In other words, as a location with two property coordinates. If the properties of the system change, there would be a new location for the new state, with different coordinates. And we could draw a line that shows how the system went from state 1 to state 2. This line, or curve in general, would be the process itself. Depending on the shape of this trajectory, meaning if it's curved or straight, concave or convex, we can potentially know something about the process itself. For some processes, the area under the curve is what's gonna determine quantities we're interested in, for example, work. But more on that later. A system is said to be in equilibrium when no properties are changing. In many cases, you can still have a process happen when one of the properties we care about is fixed. Basically, when one of the properties we are quantifying here is not changing. We'll commonly use the prefix ISO before the property's name to point this out. For example, isothermal to refer to a process where temperature is not changing, or isobaric to refer to a process where the pressure is not changing. And some others we'll learn more about in later lectures. These properties can be categorized as either extensive or intensive. We call them extensive when their value depends on the system's size, for example, volume, mass, energy. If our system size is doubled, of course the volume is doubled, and possibly the mass is too, and its energy will also change. For example, a bucket filled to the top with water at room temperature. We double the size of the bucket, we're doubling the volume and the mass of the water. We call them intensive when their value is independent of the system size, for example, temperature or density. Doubling our system size doesn't mean that the temperature is gonna double too, right? Same with the density of whatever we have inside. Again, think of the bucket filled with water example. Now, in thermodynamics, we use specific volume, the reciprocal of density, or volume over mass, a lot more than we use density, and the word specific is also very commonly used to indicate that the specific property value refers to that property per unit mass. Volume per unit mass, specific volume. Heat per unit mass, specific heat. Energy per unit mass, specific energy. Of course, specific properties will therefore be an intensive property, and again, in thermo, we use lowercase letters for the variables of specific properties. For instance, capital V is volume in cubic meters, and lowercase v is specific volume in cubic meters per kilogram, or per unit mass. The molar specific volume refers to the volume per kilomole. This means that the molar specific volume is obtained by multiplying the specific volume, which is in cubic meters per kilogram, by the molecular weight of the substance, which is kilograms per kilomole. Basically, when we use the word specific alone, we're referring to the mass specific property, whatever that property is. And when we explicitly say molar specific, we're referring to the molar specific property, meaning per mole or kilomole. And this applies not only to properties, like specific volume or internal energy, but also to quantities that go together in the conservation of energy equation that we'll learn from the next lecture. For example, heat. Capital Q refers to the total heat in the system. It's a total quantity going in or out, usually in joules or kilojoules, in metric units, of course. And lowercase q, on the other hand, would be the amount of heat per unit mass, for example, kilojoules per kilogram. Finally, if we add a dot to any of these variables, like work, heat, mass, it means that we are referring to flow. Capital Q dot would be the total heat flow, meaning the total heat Q per second, and lowercase q dot would be heat flow or heat per kilogram per second. M dot would be the mass flow or mass per second, and so on and so forth. So let's quickly go over some simple questions about control volumes for open and closed systems. Identifying a control volume and it being a closed or open system will be essential to solve for properties of interest when we analyze more complex devices. I usually have more complex examples linked in the description of these main lecture videos, but in this case, since all we cover today here are basic conceptual facts, we'll only have these simple examples, and we'll keep using everything we've learned today in future examples related to more complex topics. If we put a control volume outside a closed fridge that remains completely isolated, what type of system is that? Closed? Open? Isolated? Well, there is energy coming into the fridge in the form of electricity. One of the boundaries of the control volume we selected is allowing energy to come into our system. And what about mass? Well, we'll learn more about fridges and air conditioning systems in this course, but at least here, we're not seeing any mass leave or enter our control volume. Therefore, the system is a closed system. What about a fan and a control volume that encompasses a closed room that doesn't let air leave or come in? Well, in this case, we still have energy coming in through the wall in the form of electricity, and there is no mass entering or leaving the control volume. Therefore, this is also a closed system. Interestingly enough is that if the room is completely insulated, meaning that heat cannot leave or enter, the temperature of the room would increase as a result of the mechanical work the blades are doing. We'll understand this very soon. What about a water heater? Let's assume this is the control volume around it, and we're taking a hot shower. Well, regardless of the type of water heater, there is energy coming into the tank that holds the water for it to increase in temperature. If we're taking a shower, then water is leaving the tank, and new colder water is entering the tank on the other end. This would be an open system. And finally, what about a perfectly insulated thermos? Let's say we select a control volume that surrounds the contents of the thermos. In this case, since there is no energy coming through the boundaries and no mass leaving or entering the thermos, this would be one of the rare cases where we have an isolated system. The link to the next lecture of the thermodynamics course is found in the description of this video. You'll find the links to all the lectures of this course and other engineering courses there as well. Thanks for watching!